great mindset is a kingdom mindset. So where my Eden citizens at? Where they at? Come on now. Just do your hands just like this, y'all. Come on. Hey, hey, hey.
Spirit, it was his plan that we live blessed.
We live blessed.
Holy, holy, holy,
holy,
holy, holy,
holy.
All our praise.
Yes, Palm Sunday. So this is the day of our Lord's entry into Jerusalem, riding on a donkey. And it is also the beginning of Holy Week. So in honor of this special day, I think it is fitting that we give thanks and praise to God, don't you? So I'm going to talk about something exciting that took place in the city of Jerusalem about 2,000 years ago. And Jesus and his followers were traveling to the city of Jerusalem because the city was planning to have a big celebration called Passover that would last for a whole week. Well, as they were traveling, they came to a place called the Mount of Olives. They stopped there, and Jesus gave his disciples some special instructions. This is what he told them. Go into that village over there, he told them. As you enter it, you will see a young donkey tied there that no one has ever ridden. So this is what I want you to do. I want you to untie it and bring it here. And if anyone asks, why are you untying that donkey? Just say, the Lord needs it. So the disciples found the young donkey and took it to Jesus. They put coats on his back so that Jesus would have a nice soft seat as he rode into the town. Miss Elise has a picture of Jesus with the donkey. She's going to share it with you right now. See right here? Jesus and the donkey. See that? Hey, she's coming your way over there, so you can see the picture. Okay, thank you, Miss Elise. So word spread quickly through the town that Jesus was coming, because he had become well known for doing miracles. He did a lot of miracles. He healed the sick. He even raised the dead, and they were excited. So today, I want you to get excited too, praise God. Now here's where you come in, everybody in God's house today, children and adults. Every time you hear the word Hosanna, which is the shout of praise, children, I want you to shout, woo-hoo! Okay, children? And adults, I want you to say, yeah! Okay? Okay, so let's practice. Let's see who's ready. Hosanna!
Yeah! Yeah!
Very good. I think we're ready. Luke chapter 19, verses 37 through 38 tells us, as Jesus entered the town, a large crowd had gathered. People began to throw their coats on the road in front of Jesus. They cut branches from palm trees and waved them as they shouted, Hosanna!
Woohoo! Yeah!
Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. It must have looked like a parade as Jesus went through the streets of Jerusalem, with everyone waving, cheering, and shouting, Hosanna!
Yeah! Woohoo! Yeah!
Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna!
Yeah!
Yeah! In the highest. The good news today is that Jesus is King. He is the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Today we have come to praise Him and we shout, Hosanna!
Woo!
Yeah! Do you know what that word means? It means save now. Save now. That is why we shout, Hosanna!
Woo-hoo! Yeah!
Because Jesus saves. Jesus alone. So on this day, Palm Sunday, we give God all the praise. One more time in your loudest voice, Hosanna! Let us pray. Please fold your hands, bow your heads, and close your eyes. Dear Jesus, our voices join with the voices of the people in Jerusalem some 2,000 years ago. Thank you for saving us by dying on the cross for our sins. We praise you for being an awesome God. Hosanna in the highest. In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen.
If you turn to page 325, you will get to Deuteronomy 32. This man spent 120 years in service to God, and this is part of his farewell speech as he is trying to tell the people of Israel, whose parents disobeyed God, be different. Listen to what God says. We're looking at verses 36 to 39 of Deuteronomy 32, and I want you to see what God wants you to hear. Deuteronomy 32, verses 36 to 39, and if you're there, please say amen. The Lord will judge his people and have compassion on his servants when he sees their strength is gone. No one is left, slave or free. He will say, now where are their gods? The rock they took refuge in. The gods who ate the fat of their sacrifices and drank the wine of their drink offerings. Let them rise up to help you. Let them give you shelter. See now that I myself am he. There is no God besides me. I put to death and I bring to life. I have wounded and I will heal. And no one can deliver out of my hand. This is the word of the Lord. That's in case you needed to know which God was the right one. We're going to listen to our brother Paul as he writes to the church at Philippi. If you turn to page 1824 or 1827 in the Bibles in your pews, you will find the second chapter of the Philippian letter. We're going to look at verses 5 to 11. As you locate that in the Bibles, I'll give you a refreshment where Paul is talking about humility. He's talking about the way Christians are to be humble before God and before each other. And the question comes, what's the gold standard? What is the height of Christian humility? And you're going to hear that answer in one of the most beautiful and powerful pictures of that. Amen. Philippians 2, verses 5 to 11. And if you're there, let me know by saying amen.
Amen.
Paul, our brother, writes, your attitude should be the same as that of Christ Jesus, who, being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be grasped, but made himself nothing, taking the very form of a servant, being made in human likeness. Being found in appearance of a man, he humbled himself and became obedient to death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name, that the name of Jesus every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. This is the word of the Lord, and the proclamation of the church. In honor of Jesus Christ and his gospel, we ask that those of you who are physically able, please rise. The Holy Gospel appointed for this Sunday, Palm Sunday, is found in the gospel record of our brother, St. John, in the 12th chapter, 12 to 26, verse 1671. This is the actual arrival of Jesus on that last Sunday of his mission and ministry. John 12, verse 12. If you're there, please say amen.
Amen.
Here it comes. The next day, the great crowd that had come for the feast heard that Jesus was on his way to Jerusalem. They took palm branches and went out to meet him, shouting, Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the King of Israel. Jesus found the young donkey and sat upon it, as it is written, Do not be afraid, O daughter of Zion. See, your king is coming, seated on a donkey's colt. First, his disciples did not understand all this. Only after Jesus was glorified did they realize that these things had been written about him and that they had done these things to him. Now, the crowd that was with him when he called Lazarus from the tomb and raised him from the dead continued to spread the word. Many people, because they had heard that he had given this miraculous sign, went out to meet him. So the Pharisees said one to one another, See, this is getting us nowhere. Look how the whole world has gone after him. Now there were some Greeks among those who went to worship up at the feast. They came to Philip, who was from Bethsaida in Galilee, with a request. Sir, they said, we would like to see Jesus. Philip went to tell Andrew. Andrew and Philip in turn told Jesus. Jesus replied, The hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified. I tell you the truth. Unless a kernel of wheat falls to the ground and dies, it remains only a single seed. But if it dies, it produces many seeds. The man who loves his life will lose it, while the man who hates his life in this world will keep it for eternal life. Whoever serves me must follow me, and where I am, my servant also will be. My Father will honor the one who serves me. This is the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ.
Thanks be to God.
Take me to the lonely one.
somehow lost their way. Let them be saved. I am your friend.
We thank you for how you have been reshaping and remolding and renewing and reconnecting and reminding us that you have great things in store for us as your New Testament church. We thank you that your word has been so clear, crystal clear for us along this journey. We thank you, Holy Spirit, for opening our hearts and minds to better understand God's holy divine word for us as we meditate upon it throughout this entire journey. And now as we reach that point where we have to experience the darkness of death, but also the joy of victory in the empty grave and empty tomb, we ask you to continue to walk with us. There's still more to be done in our lives. There's still more that has to be taken away and added in. There's still more that must be accomplished through us until you come and live, Lord Jesus. And so we ask you to guide us. Call us home. in your name. Amen and amen. Saints, our 40-day Lenten journey is coming really to a dramatic and very passionate close. You know, we opened our hearts and our minds up on Ash Wednesday about 40-odd days ago to the power of the Holy Spirit. And we said, Holy Spirit, we want you during these days of Lent to really reshape us because we know who we are. You remember that? Reshape us, Holy Spirit, in these 40, 50 days as we're spending more time in prayer, more time in deep meditation, more time in the Word of God. Holy Spirit, we're going to yield ourselves. Ash Wednesday, first Sunday in Lent, we said we're going to yield ourselves, Holy Spirit, to you. Because we know we can be better Christians. We can be more Christ-like. That we can really take a hold of this work that you've given to us as a 2019 New Testament church. We can do it, Holy Spirit. Take hold of us and take us along this journey so that we can truly be the people of God that we should be. And we admit it. That we should spend more time in the Word. We can spend more time in prayer. We can spend more time in service. We admit it, that we really need to focus on fulfilling the mission of Jesus Christ. We admit it, that there are souls that need to be saved and we are the answer because we have a relationship with Jesus, saints. Amen. And finally, saints, we admit it, that our sins, we can point at ourselves, our sins are the reason why Jesus went to the cross to pay for our sins. It was our sins that God, our Heavenly Father, allowed His only begotten Son to come into this world and be wrapped in swaddling clothes in a manger in Bethlehem, and that our Savior in a manger becomes our Savior on the cross as well. For 33 years, Jesus walked amongst us, teaching us in parables and miracles, giving us wisdom, and then going to the grave and rising on the third day in victory. And in these days, our deep meditation and prayer has guided us to today. Hosanna! 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 Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Amen. Say, there are several voices that you heard and did not hear along the Jerusalem road this morning in our gospel text. Those that you heard the shouts, Hosanna, 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 blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. But those are the individuals that Jesus came back to Jerusalem to remind them what he did for them. Jesus, many of those individuals were recipients of the healing that Jesus brought into their town. Many of those individuals were willing to sit down and listen to Jesus' words of wisdom and teaching about what thus saith God, our Heavenly Father. Many of those individuals ran up to Jesus and touched the hem of his garment, and they were healed. Many of those individuals were in the presence of Jesus. They felt him radiating toward them, and they were blessed by the Spirit of God. Many of those individuals, Jesus guided to this place in their life where they knew that he was the Messiah that would save them and give them all that they needed and that would secure their place in heaven. So that's the reason why when you be along that road going, Hosanna, come back again. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord because he wants some more. Amen. Those are the ones that are shouting and screaming and so excited that he's back. More miracles, more teaching, more wisdom, more insight from God our Heavenly Father through Jesus Christ. Amen. There's some other voices that you did not hear, maybe you did hear. The Pharisees and the Sadducees, the church folk, they were along the road. Now some of them had actually allowed their faith in secret, all right, to be known. And so they had something to shout about, but they probably weren't going to be too loud. Hosanna, 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 Hosanna. Not too loud, right? They don't want to be called out by the other Pharisees and Sadducees than those of the temple priests of the law. Some of those did have faith in God. And so others still questioned the proclamation of this long-awaited Messiah. All the things that God took them through in the desert for 40 years. All the manna he gave them from heaven. Departing the Red Sea from the boat to bring them into the promised land. And they bring them the Messiah and they still would not believe because they believe the law of the land versus the freedom of the gospel of Jesus Christ standing in their midst. You didn't hear much from them. Because they were waiting to trap Jesus. They were waiting to nail Jesus to the cross. They were ready to say, crucify him, crucify him, crucify him. Those are the church people. Waiting to trap Jesus and to be sure that he would know that he is not the one that God sent into this world. And others may know that they're still waiting on their Messiah to arrive on the scene. Didn't hear much of those voices, the government officials. There's the other voices, the government official voices. You didn't hear much of them at all. They were representing Pilate. They were crowd control. Amen? All that excitement, all the parade, all the fanfare that was there, those government officials stood there and they watched it all take place and make sure everything was in order. So we didn't hear from them, but who knows where their faith was at in Jesus Christ as they stood there saying, they were there watching and being sure that nothing got out of control. They didn't show much bias. They didn't have much to say at all. They just upheld the law of the land. Stand here and keep everything in order. But who knows how the power of Jesus Christ and the sounds of praise and thanks of Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna impacted those government officials representing Pilate. Amen. But they were there for crowd control. But they were there listening, watching, and see our Lord and our Savior Jesus Christ coming back into Jerusalem. And finally, the voice of the children. We often talk about the voices of the children shouting, Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna. These innocent children, saints. Their voices represented the heart of Jesus Christ as he rides back into Jerusalem. Their voices are innocent, they're hopeful, they're praiseworthy, they're thankful, they have unspeakable joy. They're watching those who are saved, those who have put their faith in Jesus Christ. They're just mimicking them, right? Oh, my mother's excited, my father's excited, my uncle's excited, other people are excited. I'm going to join in on the excitement. I'm going to be in a parade. You know what it's like to be in a parade. And all the excitement and the joy is there, and the voice of those innocent children shouting, oh, Hosanna to Jesus, shouting, oh, Hosanna to our Messiah. Those innocent children touched Jesus' heart. Because they acknowledged the fact that he came to save them as well. Beautiful picture of the Jerusalem Road. All the voices on the Jerusalem Road. Some that we actually hear, and some that we do not hear from. Amen? Say, so many times when we look back, when it gets to Palm Sunday, and we look along the Jerusalem Road, we have to really think of the full picture of the impact of Jesus coming before he goes to the cross. Because it gives us a better understanding and a deeper passion and acceptance of the fact that Jesus was there because people lacked faith in him. He had to come back one more time. Jesus came back there because of their sin. Their idolatry, their selfishness, their plain old stupidity. He had been amongst them for 3 years, performing miracles, and still he was struggling with them to put their faith in them. He came back because some of them were still on their way to hell. And he said, I want to do all I can do in Jerusalem, like the city of Los Angeles, to be sure that these individuals are not left in the grip of Satan, but have a relationship with a powerful God. Amen? Palm Sunday, for the New Testament church, those of us today, it really does connect us to the final hours of hearing our Lord and our Savior Jesus Christ's wisdom and teaching. But it also connects to the final hour, saints, where we have to hear the crowds and the Sadducees and the Pharisees say, crucify him, crucify him, crucify him. We have to hear that as well. We have to feel the sadness of God, our Heavenly Father, knowing that the only solution for this fallen world is his Son. the blood of His Son, our Savior Jesus Christ, to be the sacrificial lamb that would pay for the sins of the world once and for all. We have to experience the grace and the mercy, unconditional love coming from the Father through the Son's sacrifice to keep us humble, really. To remind us we need to be more grateful and more thankful that Jesus came and completed the Father's mission, saints. Amen. That's something to shout about. Hosanna! Something to shout about. Palm Sunday also begins this last few days of our journey to see some very difficult things happen in the temple and outside the temple. It's also our time to read some things that are really going to disgust us this coming week. Totally disgust us, saints. The rejection, the insults, the hatred, the lies, the schemes, the total overshadowing of sin. It's going to disgust us this week. When we read about the disciples, it's going to make us upset. Do they stand by Jesus' side after 3 years? No, they run somewhere and they hide. Do they take hold of Jesus' mission immediately? No, they need to go figure out who's next. After an amazing 3 years of an intimate relationship with Jesus, they don't stick to His side to the end, saints. We have to read about that this week. We have to read about sin and the sin-sick world and the rejection that this world had for Jesus. And then we'll get to Friday, where we'll hear those nails being driven into Jesus' hands and driven into Jesus' feet. And that sword being pierced in His side and the blood pushing from His side and the water coming out of His side as He hangs there on a cross in the heat of the day. We'll have to hear about the crown of thorns that they put together to put upon His head, and as they put it on there, the blood gushes from His head and runs down His face. We'll have to hear about that on Friday, saints. We'll have to hear the cries of worry and fear and doubt and shame and embarrassment of sin that the Savior of the world is on the cross, saints. We'll have to hear that on Friday, saints. And then we're here on Friday from our Lord and our Savior, Jesus Christ. It is finished. It is finished. What does that mean, saints? The Father's will has been done. What does it mean? Father, into Your hands I commit my spirit. I'm coming home, Father. I've got it done. What does it mean, saints? Father, I reconnect myself to my place, my righteous place in heaven. I'm shedding this old human body. What does it mean, saints? I give these men, women, and children back to You. I've done my best. Those who trust in Me will have heaven, and those who don't will experience the death of hell. What does it mean? Father, let Thy will be done. Saints, I pray, and I strongly suggest to us as a church, that as we approach Dark Friday, as we approach Holy Saturday, as we approach Victory Sunday morning, that we take full advantage, saints, to listen to the voice of God through His word, through prayer and in meditation. I pray, church, that we'll be willing to redo our routine life this coming week especially and give a little bit of it back to God. I pray that the Lenten sacrifices that we started, that we began on Ash Wednesday, that we will remember what their meaning is and what they're supposed to do for us today. I pray that we'll be able to really look at our family members and our friends, our loved ones, our neighbors, the stranger, the person in the marketplace that we see all the time, and that we will remember them and we will allow them to be ushered into the presence of Jesus by simply inviting them to church. Would you like to go to church on Easter Sunday morning? All they can do is say no. But our responsibility, saint, is not to bring a harvest. Our responsibility is to sow a seed, a gospel seed. Amen. And that gospel seed, God will be able to work with and to bring into its full fruition. Amen. So that the church of God, the church of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, will accomplish much things if we are faithful with the gospel seed that we plant into people's hearts. We have to remember something, saints. Jesus said, I don't know the day nor the hour that God the Father is going to send me back. Only God the Father knows. And we have to remember, Jesus makes it very clear that he's coming again. He's coming again soon. He makes it very clear. He makes it very clear to us that we have a responsibility with the jewels and the gifts that he's given to us as his church. That we have to do something with it as a people of God. He makes it very clear that he loves us unconditionally. He makes it very clear that he's prepared a place in heaven for every last one of us. It's secure now. So the shouts of praise, Hosanna, 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 was the faith of the believers that heaven was their home and that Jesus was the Messiah that would secure their home for them. Hosanna!
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 Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Amen. Let's pray. Lord God, Heavenly Father, what a joy to continue to allow your Spirit to shape us and to mold us and to guide us to sow these gospel seeds in this coming Holy Week. Thank you for giving us the good news. Thank you for giving us passion, determination that resembles you, Lord Jesus, and all that you are to us. Thank you for not leaving us to our own accord, that this world would have its way with us. But thank you, Lord Jesus, that we have power over sin, over death, and over the grave. Now may we take this message to the streets so that those around us may know that they have a place already prepared for them. And the person who's prepared before them, his name is Jesus. In this most holy week, we say, mold us, shape us, prune us, and prepare us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.